Sridhar Narayanan from IMSC, and he'll speak about character polynomials and generating functions. Go ahead.
Thank you for this opportunity. Today I want to talk about certain generating functions associated to character polynomials. The motivation for this comes from trying to study symmetric group representations, and we are interested in the multiplicities of the irreducible symmetric group representations. In all of the cases that we discuss, a combinatorial interpretation for these multiplicities are open problems. Failing to have such an interpretation, we would like to see a closed form expression for these multiplicities. And failing that, we try to look for generating functions, and we use character polynomials to find them. So let's begin with a partition. A partition is a non-increasing sequence of integers. The size of the partition is the sum of those integers. So here we see a partition of 7. Its size is 7 and its length is 3 because it has 3 parts. Partitions play a central role in the representation theory of symmetric groups. We all know that the irreducible representations of SN are indexed by partitions of size n. If you have a partition lambda, you can pad it out to be of a larger size by adding a first row that is of length n minus the size of lambda. Now we only can do this if n satisfies this condition, because in that case, when we add a new row, it is going to be the first row. So it's only defined for n greater than the size of lambda plus the first row of lambda. If you vary n in this way, then you get a sequence of partitions that are constructed from lambda. And so you get a sequence of spec modules after some, if you vary n, given that n is big enough, some minimum integer. And this will come into play a little bit later. I just wanted to mention it here. So the Kronecker problem is one of the problems that we are trying to develop generating functions for. What the Kronecker problem says is if you take two representations of SN and then you tensor them, then that is a representation of SN. And so what is a combinatorial interpretation for the multiplicities of each of the irreducible SN representations? This problem is of course open. Of course, partitions also play a central role in the representation theory of GLN. We know that the irreducible polynomial representations of GLN are indexed by partitions with at most n parts. We call these irreducible modules Weil modules. The restriction problem, in a similar spirit to the Kronecker problem, says that if you restrict GLN to the subgroup isomorphic to SN, that is the subgroup of permutation matrices. So if you restrict an irreducible polynomial representation of GLN to this subgroup, what is a combinatorial interpretation for the multiplicities of each of the irreducible symmetric group representations? So these coefficients are called restriction coefficients. Right. So that was a problem, and now here is a method. So recall that a class function is just one that is constant on conjugacy classes. Here in this example, we can see some class functions of symmetric groups. So xi of a permutation is the number of I cycles in that permutation. It's defined the same way on all symmetric groups. So for this example, this permutation has 1 1 cycle, so x1 is 1. It has 2 2 cycles, so x2 is 2. And it has 1 3 cycle, so x3 is 1. These xi's are the building blocks for polynomials, which are called character polynomials. Right. So as I read out this definition, it would be helpful to keep in mind the case of the padded partition that we just mentioned as a prototypical example. So if you have a sequence of representations of SN, like VN, so each VN is a representation of SN. So if you have such a sequence, this sequence is said to have eventually polynomial character if there is a polynomial in these class functions x1, x2, etc., such that eventually the evaluation of this polynomial on any permutation is equal to the character of Vn on that permutation, right? So it's in the name, character polynomial. So let's look at an example. Let's take a sequence Vn, where Vn is sim2cn. This is a second symmetric tensor power. You can think of sim2cn as multisets of size 2 with elements drawn from 1 to 3 up to n. So its character polynomial is given by this expression. this expression counts the number of ways of constructing a two-element multiset that is fixed by a permutation that has x1 one cycles, x2 two cycles, etc. So you can choose a fixed point of the permutation in x1 ways, and you can repeat it twice. So that's a two-element multiset. Or you can choose a two cycle of a permutation. That is a two-element set, in fact. Or you can choose two distinct fixed points from the permutation, and that also is a two-element set. And all of these are the only ones that are fixed by this permutation. So this is the character polynomial associated to this sequence. What we are interested in, first off, is to try to get at the character polynomials of Weyl module, which are the irreducible GLN module. And we do this through the intermediate step of finding character polynomials for sim lambda CN. So if lambda is a partition and its parts are lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda L, sim lambda is defined as a tensor product, sim lambda 1, tensor sim lambda 2, etc., up to sim lambda L, sim lambda L. Right? And so if we denote its character polynomial by H lambda, then the generating function for H lambda, that is H lambda T lambda sum of it, is equal to this expression that you see on the right. Right? And now what I mean by T lambda, this is vector notation. So what I mean by T lambda is T1 raised to lambda 1, T2 raised to lambda 2, etc. So T is actually several variable, a vector of several variables. Now, given this generating function, we can use the Jacobi-Trudy identity to get at the generating function, to get at the generating function for the character polynomial for Weyl modules. I'm not going to mention what Jacobi-Trudy identity is, but its effect on the generating function is just to introduce this extra term, delta t. Delta t is defined as the product of 1 minus tj over ti for all I and for all j greater than I. So when I use capital T, what I mean is that T is a variable set. So T, so this is delta in the variables T1, T2, etc. So this is just some shorthand notation. So, okay. So now we have one part of the puzzle. We have the character polynomial of the Weyl module. Now, the other part of it, as we hinted at before, would be a character polynomial for those padded partitions. Recall that you have a partition and then you add a long first row and you can make it of some size, right, of some fixed size n. So that sequence also has a character polynomial associated to it. We call it the spec character polynomial. It occurs in a work by McDonald, but we use this recursive formula that is because of Garcia and Goupil, right? So it expresses Q lambda, which is a character polynomial of this family of spec modules V lambda n. It expresses it in terms of Q R lambda. R lambda is lambda minus lambda with its first row removed. Okay, so you have an expression for Q lambda in terms of a partition, which is basically lambda minus its first part, times this expression here. Now this down arrow is called the umbral operator. And how it works is you expand this term, Ixi minus 1 raised to Ai, you expand it using binomial theorem into a sum of monomials in Xi. And to each monomial in Xi, you change Xi raised to j to the term you see here. This term is just Xi falling factorial j. I just written it slightly differently, but it is Xi falling factorial j. And this operation is called the umbral operator. Right. So we were able to clean up the original expression of Garcia to give this expression that is more amenable to generating function. And here, this summation symbol is actually a shorthand for a double summation. I've defined it here, but you can understand it abstractly as a sum of this expression that follows here. In this expression, theta 1, theta 2, up to theta L, they are all partitions. So you're going to sum this expression over various ranges for the sizes of these partitions, theta 1, theta 2, up to theta L, which may come with some sign. So it's not a positive sum. But yeah, it's just summed over certain ranges of the sizes, right? Right. So in principle, we have a character polynomial for spec modules, and we have a character polynomial for Weyl modules. So that should be enough to calculate both the Kronecker coefficient and the restriction coefficient. And how we do this is we treat the character polynomials as class functions, which they are for some n. So we treat them as class functions and then just evaluate the inner product on class function, which is the expression you see on the right here, right? So this is what we're going to do. And so let's jump in to the generating functions now. Before we get into it, I realize generating functions may not be familiar to everyone here. So just a primer on if you have a sequence of numbers, a subscript n, so a depends on this variable n, then you encode it as a generating function where an is the coefficient of the monomial x raised to n, right? And this belongs to a power sum ring. In this example, let's look at the generating function for pnk, which is the number of partitions of n into at most k part. So already the example is slightly more complex than this, I wouldn't say definition, but introduction. It's already more complicated than that, which is a hint that the generating functions we are going to look at shortly involve several more variables than just one or two, right? So we form this generating function, which is in two variables because it has two arguments, right? And we have this form for this generating function. I won't go into why, but this is called a rational form for the generating function because it's expressible as a rational function, right? Right, so let's look at the actual generating functions. First, we have this generating function where the Kronecker coefficient occurs as the coefficient of the monomial u raised to lambda, v raised to mu, w raised to nu. And recall that these are again vector notation. Also, we have a variable z raised to n. So this counts n. And the generating function for this is this quite complicated looking expression here. Delta u, as you remember, is just the product of 1 minus uj over ui for all j is greater than I. And it's similar in the other variable sets. Now, E of u is the alternating sum of elementary symmetric functions in the variables u1, u2, etc. So it's 1 minus e1 plus e2 minus e3 and so on. And it's the same for all the other variable sets. Right. So as I said, this is a function in n. These Kronecker coefficients are a function in n, but as n grows, they eventually stabilize. Right? And their stable coefficients are called reduced Kronecker coefficients. The generating function for those is quite easy to get from this expression. The generating function for those is quite easy from this expression. You just remove the e terms. So you just remove e u, e, e v, e w, and then you have this expression, and then the product in the denominator changes slightly because we will discard all the terms where at least two of these are zero, right? So we only consider ones where at least two of ij and k are non-zero. Also, we can also ask for the generating function where these coefficients are the coefficients of the Schur functions, s lambda in the variables u, s mu in the variables v, and s nu in the variables w. And you can get this quite easily from these expressions. You just have to remove the delta term. So here's what I'm talking about. This generating function where the Kronecker coefficients are coefficients of Schur function. And as you see, it just deleted the deltas and nothing else changes. This was the case for Kronecker coefficients. The look for restriction coefficients is similar. It's a similar story. So here, restriction coefficients occurring as coefficients of the monomial. You have this expression. This is more or less the same as the previous one. There's just one point to explain. This square subset, when I say square subset, I mean a multiset. So this is a multiset drawn from elements 1, 2, 3, etc. up to L lambda. So 1, 1, 1, 2, 2 of any size, right? And you have this expression. And again, to get to the stable form, you just delete the U and you exclude from the product the term where I equals 0 and T is the empty set. And also you drop the Z because we don't need Z anymore, right? So this is the stable form. So these two generating functions in the Schur basis, you know, the trick is just delete the deltas. Nothing else changes. Right. So these are some quite complex generating functions that we just saw. We should ask if any results are recoverable from them. As we found out, several results are recoverable from these generating functions that are already known in the literature. For example, this result of Littlewood that says that the restriction coefficient is the coefficient of the Schur function S lambda in the expansion of this expression in the Schur basis, right? So what this expression is called a plethysm. You can look that up, but I'll define it for completeness. A plethysm is the substitution of the monomials of the term in the bracket, so of the term 1 plus h1 plus h2. It's the substitution of the monomials occurring there into the variables of the Schur function S mu of n. That is a plethysm, and you can expand it into a Schur basis, and the coefficient of S lambda is the restriction function, restriction coefficient. And we can prove this using our generating function. Another expression is for the reduced Kronecker coefficient in terms of the actual Kronecker coefficients for smaller partitions. And so this should be an E. Yeah. And some Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. Right. So these I call these generalized Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. They're just products of two Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. So it is the multiplicity of V lambda, the spec module V lambda, when you induce VA cross VX cross VY from a Young subgroup. That's what this coefficient is, right? I'm not claiming that this is a new result, although I haven't seen exactly this result in literature. I've seen the reverse result, where these Kronecker coefficients are expressed in terms of reduced Kronecker coefficient. And I'm quite sure it should follow from some existing result in the literature quite easily. But because of this result and the generating function, certain corollaries follow easily in this case, namely Moynihan's criteria. Now, Moynihan's criteria is a triangularity condition on the sizes of the partition. So it says if the size of one partition is greater than the sum of the sizes of the other two partitions, these reduced Kronecker coefficients are zero. Right? And then Littlewood's result says that when the size of a partition is exactly equal to the sum of the sizes of the other two, then the restricted or reduced Kronecker coefficients are in fact the Littlewood-Richardson coefficients. Also, from these generating functions, it's quite easy to deduce this generating function of Mercedes-Rosas for reduced Kronecker coefficients of hook shapes. So this is hook shapes, if you recall, if you remove the first row, is just a column shape. So she has this generating function. Although I will say that her paper, the proof of this identity in her paper is more combinatorial and much more elegant. So we cannot recreate that part of it, but we can recreate the results. I've run out of space to list the limitations, but there are a few limitations to this approach. The main among them being that these are multivariate generating functions, and so they're very complex. It's very hard to get information out of them. And eventually, to get any information, we need to express them as symmetric functions, which kind of invalidates the claim that this is a different approach if you're just going to do symmetric functions at the end of it. So what the hope is that we can connect these generating functions to other areas of math where similar generating functions exist. For example, polyhedral combinatorics, like counting fixed points in polytopes, similar types of generating functions occur there. And so if we are able to do that, we can import tools from that area for the study of this problem. And I hope that happens at some point. Thank you for listening. That was my talk.
Oh, thank you, Sridhar.